Immobilien, Städte, Menschen. Der ULI Germany Podcast mit Gestaltern der gebauten Umwelt, Machern der Immobilienbranche und Persönlichkeiten, die unsere Städte prägen.
Hello and welcome to the ULI Germany Podcast, the first episode in English. My name is Stephanie Baden. I'm the Executive Director ULI Germany, Austria and Switzerland. And my guest and interlocutor today is Alexander Otto, CEO of ECE, a leading European shopping center operator. Hello, Alex.
Hello, Stephanie.
Unfortunately, we cannot record this conversation sitting together in one room as I usually do, but digitally, which means you are in Hamburg and I'm in Frankfurt. Alex, you are 52 years old, and in addition to many functions in companies and organizations, it should of course be emphasized that you are a ULI Life Trustee. Before we get down to business and talk about the crisis, its impact on shopping center, the future of retail and ECE in particular, the most important question, how are you doing and how did you personally experience the lockdown?
Oh, I'm doing fine. Thank you very much. And of course, this situation was completely new to me, like to everybody else. And well, before we get to all the big critical impact on the economy and on real estate, I think personally, in some ways, it was a very special experience, just being close to my family, spending time in a different way, spending a lot more time at home, interacting very closely, of course, with other family members, really getting in touch with friends, spending more time talking to them. And so in that sense, it was a very intense experience and in many ways also a very positive experience. However, at the same time, it was extremely difficult to forget about everything that's going around you, of course, with all the suffering out there in the world, with not only the big medical consequences and loss of life, but also, of course, a big impact on the economy. So in that sense, of course, it was not possible really to forget about this. But at least it was a different experience and it helped. And I talked to a lot of other people as well who also think it was certainly a different approach to life and probably a lot more chance to listen to your loved ones and communicate.
The lockdown has enormously hit the retail sector. How can we imagine the dimension at ECE in terms of footfall, loss of rent, etc.?
Well, of course, footfall is very easy at the time. The centers were closed, the footfalls were down like up to 80% or so because we only had the day-to-day merchandise in our centers that was offered. So the food stores, the drug stores, the pharmacy, some smaller food units. So in that sense, of course, lots of attractiveness. And now, of course, we are ramping up again, but footfall is still not back to normal levels. Depending on each individual location, we are at the moment somewhere between 50 and 90% of the previous year. Of course, some stores in some countries are open a little bit longer, like in Austria already, or for example, some centers where we have a high proportion of day-to-day merchandise, there we also have a relatively normal shopping frequency, but some of the bigger super regional malls, especially those that are out of town, they are at the moment still very weak in terms of customer traffic. And I think it will take a little bit of time really to restore this confidence of the customer, also to go out there to meet other people. Shopping there with a mask, that's something that you need to get used to. So I think one has to be realistic and it will take some time to get back to normal.
Coming from footfall to loss of rent, how does it look like?
Loss of rent at the moment, of course, a bit too early to tell. We had collection rates all over the board. In some countries, even there was a possibility to stop paying rent completely, like in Poland. So we had very low collection rates in the teens. In other countries, already quite high. But on average, we had about 40% now for April and same about for May. And at the moment, of course, we are negotiating a lot of compromises with tenants in Germany. As you know, tenants who had an impact by Corona had the possibility for the moment to not to pay rent. And at the moment, we are negotiating with them about possible rent relief, but also of shifting rental payments forward.
Would a reduction of value added tax currently help retailers?
Yeah, I think it is, of course, positive, and it will help consumption somewhat. I think, though, at the moment, the main impact of retail sales is not really that prices are not attractive on the consumers, because especially in the clothing retail, you have already big reductions in prices and everybody trying to sell out the merchandise as quickly as they can. But I think only lower price helps in a limited way in this current environment. So I'm sure it's going to help, but probably later and further down the road.
Immobilienzeitung, one of Germany's most important journal for the real estate industry, wrote in its editorial 2 weeks ago that ECE would be in a tight squeeze, being servant of many masters. Could you please explain this and thus describe ECE and its business model in more detail to our listeners?
So what's very important for me to point out first is that we are not in the least in a tight squeeze in financial terms at all. We are, I think, probably one of the most solid companies out there in the business because we are fully equity financed and have a very strong balance sheet and really work, including our development work in many areas outside of shopping purely from equity. So in that sense, we are, despite Corona, which of course is a very hard hit for us, in a very solid financial position. I think what here the writer means is that indeed, of course, in our role as an asset manager, we have different customers. We have the end customer who is at the moment very insecure, where consumption is not in the core focus of the customer. We have the tenant who at the moment wants, of course, rental reductions if possible and economic relief. And of course, we have the investors who want to maintain their legal right to as much rental payment as possible. And clearly, of course, those are divergent goals of these three different groups that we have to serve. And in this sense, of course, this creates a lot of work for us. I think, though, as an asset manager, this is normal business for us. At the moment, I have to admit, this is, of course, gets us to the limit. We really have a lot of hard work in front of us to really reconcile all these different interests. But I think we are on a very good way. And I think the key point is really to try to take everybody along this journey and to understand the position a bit better of the others, to really explain the difficult situations the retailers are facing to our investors. At the same time, of course, to really try and also show the retailers what the investors' view is, because a lot of them, of course, have taken out loans to finance their investments and they need the rental payments to come in, or at least there are limits to the rental reductions that you can make. And in that sense, we're really finding a lot of common ground at the moment. And these are the types of challenges we have to master in our job. And of course, this, I always view challenges as something positive. So in that sense, we will definitely cope with this.
Does such an article annoy you?
Oh, you know, after being so many years in such a position, of course, we are used to that journalists who are a bit more critical also accompany us. And so in that sense, I have to admit that I don't give a lot of thought to it in the meantime. 15 years ago, I have to say I did have a sleepless night sometimes after a critical article, but I have to admit, at the moment, of course, the communication is so open. There's so many opinions out there. And although I have a very different opinion to the writer of the article, to the journalist, we try and still, of course, follow these articles and try and also are very open, try to be transparent with the information that we offer.
From space to feeling. Now, all shops in Germany are open again with what you've already mentioned, access restrictions, distance rules, and face masks. So we are far from a normal shopping experience. Shops and centers have already been shifting their appearance away from passive presenting product areas to experience spaces for brands. How do you see the medium to long-term development in the purchase behavior of consumers in shopping centers? And how do you lead the experience change in your projects?
Of course, a key point and key focus of our initiative in the last couple of years was to really enhance shopping experience in the centers. And we see that customers view that very positively. We renovated most of our portfolio, brought it really up to date, created big lounge zones, restaurant areas, etc. And that is definitely a trend. Of course, in the current situation with Corona, Unfortunately, this is not en vogue or not so much allowed that we have to close up some of these areas, and gastronomy largely is closed during this time. So, but I do not think that this will really interrupt this long-term trend. But at the moment, of course, it has halted somewhat. And I think will also lead to also some bankruptcies, especially for some of the restaurants in the business. On the other hand, there's some other major trends that are going on that, of course, have been sped up by this process, including, of course, the trend towards digitalization. And I think a lot of retailers are really realizing the benefits of an omni-channel presence. And we see that especially those that are strong on the online sales really did not feel such an impact as others who did not have web pages. And it was quite interesting that some retailers really experienced a tremendous growth in their online sales at this time, not, of course, sufficient to compensate the loss by closing all the stores, but gave them still an opportunity to really do a lot better than expected. And I honestly think this is the future. We are working very closely together with Otto Group, our sister company and the number two online retailer in Europe. We work very closely together with them to create a digital mall to really give customers the opportunity to view local assortments in all shopping centers directly from their portable device. And the idea is to really try and be able to deliver from the mall within a year or two from now in our portfolio. We are doing this already and have piloted this in our Alstertal shopping center in Hamburg and has been tremendously successful. So I wish we'd been a little bit further along technologically, because then this corona crisis would have been very beneficial. But we see that a lot of retailers are really embracing this project and are very interested in it, all the more now than were previously. But I think everybody sees that this multi-channel experience is really key to the future.
Would it be an opportunity for shopping centers to think of consumers as guests?
Of course, at the moment during Corona, again, this is probably not the case, because we really see at the moment is successful more the daily needs and customers, they're coming and they're coming to buy and unfortunately, not to stay so long, but really then to leave the centers quite closely. But this, from week to week, we see that the consumers are getting more and more confidence. At the moment, they still have to wear face masks in most centers due to regional restrictions. A lot of them don't like that much, but we are seeing also that consumers are getting used to that as well. And I see it also from my own personal experience, walking through a center with a face mask on. In the beginning, it bothered me, and now I hardly notice this anymore, and I don't even take it off right away afterwards. So like with many things, it's something to get used to. Now, of course, in general, all these programs I described and the previous questions are really aimed at this, to really treat our customers really as guests and to not only deliver a shopping experience, but really also somewhat of an entertainment experience that's taking place and a gastronomic experience.
The city is a subject close to your heart. Firstly, 20 years ago, you established the Lebendige Stadt Foundation, which promotes the revitalization of European inner cities. Secondly, which is of course especially important for me and many others, you are the one who launched ULA Germany more than 10 years ago. Great that you did this. How do you see the long-term effects of the current crisis on cities and retail as one of the core functions of urban areas?
Of course, the crisis at the moment really has a big impact on cities, because, of course, there are longer term trends in retail, especially including the strengthening of online retailing. And there are trends we've seen in the last couple of years also with a lot of retailer bankruptcies and change of assortments taking place in the cities. But at the moment, through this corona crisis, everything is really being sped up a lot, and a lot of development, which I assume would take place anyway within 3 or 5 years, it really came to very rapid development within a couple of weeks. And that's, of course, initially not very positive for a city because there's a danger that vacancies will be created in the city and that it will lose a bit liveliness because at the moment, naturally, there's not a lot of demand for new retail space and a lot of stores just have to sort out their problems. At the same time, we see that others are going bankrupt. So I think this is something critical. At the same time, of course, there always is an opportunity with every change that's taking place. And what I will foresee is that the face of the city is also continuing to change. And maybe some assortments who couldn't afford a rent in a very good quality location, we will see them coming back to the high street again or to a shopping center, or also entertainment functions really coming to a shopping center. So in that sense, I think there's a tremendous change that will be going on, but also some with opportunity. I think, though, that some of the retail space will be used in a different way in the future, including, for example, for doctors' offices. So combinations of walk-in functions with office type of usages. But I think it will take some time until this change will be fully realized.
The topic of sustainability has been one of the most important topics of all and has increasingly come into focus due to global warming. The topic of fast fashion is rightly under massive criticism. Every German, for example, buys on average 60 items of clothing a year, of which 1 in 5 is almost never worn. Even if some large clothing chains advertise recycling measures, not even 1% of the material is reused. Old clothes are 80% burned or destroyed, and I won't even expand on waste of resources, working conditions, etc. Fast fashion representatives make up a large part of the tenants in shopping centers and have now corona-conditionally big problems. My question to you is to what extent the classic retail sector now has a chance to change from fast fashion to fair fashion? And would a change in this respect be an opportunity for the shopping center of the future? Or is the center dependent on the chain stores in the long term?
Well, you know, of course, sustainability, as you know, is a huge topic with many different areas. And one part of it is, of course, the retailers in the shopping centers. And there is a lot of waste, of course, everywhere going on. It's the same actually in the food business, I think even more so, because I think 50% of all food that's being produced is thrown away. And that's, of course, not very good how we as a society deal with our resources. Of course, I think what's positive is that consumers in general are a lot more aware of sustainability issues. And I think that's already absolute key that everybody thinks about it. At the same time, of course, there's a lot of structural waste taking place. And if you really analyze the tenant sales over the years, some of the most successful concepts were those in the fast fashion area, those that have produced cheap clothing. And this shows a bit to me that I think people embrace more and more the idea of sustainability. But in the end, very often they don't act on it this way, or at least not entirely on it. And I think if we look at our own behavior, we can probably see every one of us probably has shown improvements in several ways. But then there might be other ways where we still make the wrong choices. And it's just a learning process taking place. So I'm trying to go out now and not try to avoid plastic bags really at all costs and really always take a shopping bag along. And it's so easy when you think about it, really. But at the same time, maybe, and I think that's what this corona crisis also shows us, maybe I should have attended some business meetings less, or they should have been organized like a video conference, like our meeting here today. For example, initially, Stephanie, you were planning to come to Hamburg, and now maybe the quality of the recording might not be quite ideal, but at the same time, of course, we're doing something positive for the environment. But this is just one example of many, and it's a very deep process. But honestly, I think the trend towards sustainability, which is not only a very important one, it's really crucial for us and for future generations. I think maybe the corona crisis helped us and helped this trend along, that people realize more and more what is possible to do from home, that also you can organize an exciting free time without maybe doing a big traveling to the Caribbean, but that there are beautiful areas and spots to discover with a bike just in the area around you, and that maybe you don't need to fly to every meeting. In that sense, I think we're also learning from it. But I think one key issue is as well that how important it is to cooperate internationally as well, because this virus shows that there's the virus and medicine doesn't really have a border. Virus spreads beyond it, and it's so important on a global level we are talking to each other. And I think it's the same in these sustainability questions. It's so important to talk to each other, to support, and maybe also to allocate resources to areas where with somewhat limited financial resources, we can really do a lot to save mankind. If I think about the rainforests in South America and in Africa. And so I do hope that we will allocate more resources there in the future.
Wouldn't it be a good step towards sustainability to integrate more or even fair fashion shops into your shopping centers?
Oh, it's you know, it's important for a lot of our shops, of course. I don't have to go far with our own Otto group. Of course, this is absolutely key to us, and they're thinking very much through every part of the production processes of clothing, including also what happens with us afterwards. And we have a number of stores like Lascana underwear, for example, in our shopping centers. And I think it's also, I think the customers welcome this. They think it's very positive. The only thing that I mean is, unfortunately, very often when there's a discount from another store, then still too many say, okay, what the heck, now I'll buy the cheap thing anyway.
As a socially active person, we've already seen major upheavals in politics and society before the outbreak of Corona. How do you feel about the current mood in Germany regarding restrictions, fears of the future, and thus in dealing with politics?
You know, honestly, at the moment, I feel that we are all in an extremely difficult situation, and there's so many people who are in medical danger on the one hand, others who are worried about their jobs, others who are really losing a lot of what they've built up over many years and maybe have their business that's at risk of going bankrupt. And given this very difficult situation, I think it's really enormous how positively people responded to the measures of the government, and also that the government with its measures had a lot of success and acceptance from the population. So in that sense, I think it's really unifying us. Just at the moment, of course, there are a number of protests where people are looking back and said we should have done it or could have done it in a different way. Unfortunately, at a timing when we are still not through this crisis yet, they're congregating, they're disregarding some of the necessary social distances. So in that sense, this worries me, and I don't think it's very good at all. And I wish, and ideally, this unity will remain at least until this crisis has passed. But of course, there's a right for everybody to assemble and to free speech. But I think, especially in a difficult situation like this, that's unheard of, I think we need leadership from politics. And I think politics has provided the leadership. And looking back, although probably most of us would have done some things somewhat different, I think overall politics has been very successful, and we were very comforted by the good leadership we had in most countries.
My last question is usually about football. I know your heart beats for HSV, the football club in Hamburg. The world of sport is currently looking at the Bundesliga, the German Premier League. What do you say to matches behind closed doors?
Well, of course, I think everybody would have wished to have filled stadiums and a football game. Watching it on television, it's very different when you have empty stadiums than to have filled stadiums. So it's clearly not an ideal situation. But at the same time, I understand the Deutsche Football League that they try to proceed with this because, as you know, football is a very big business, and and the key income source are television monies. And for that reason, I think it's just important to continue the season so that they can continue paying the salaries to the players and securing the jobs also in this business, all the people who are involved around the and as part of the clubs and on the advertising side. So in that sense, I think it was the right decision to continue on. I think the measures also, it's good. They're very strict also in terms of the social distancing. So I'm glad that it's proceeding. But I do hope next year again, I can hopefully in the next season visit a game again in the stadium.
Well, this is interesting, Alex. This is a business-related answer. Will HSV make it back into the first Bundesliga this year?
Oh, you know, it's changing from week to week, of course. And we are very lucky this weekend that we could win the game against Wiesbaden. So we're still up there in the running. But it's really hard to make a prognosis. And I've been asked this many times over the last couple of years. Will Hamburg remain in the first league? Will they come up again? So I'd rather not tell. I almost feel it's a bad omen if I'm too positive. But I do hope very much we are in the first league again next year.
Since I'm from Cologne, I know how you feel.
Yeah, exactly.
And I spare myself the very last question, who will be the German football champion this year? It seems like it's all been coming down to one club for years, or don't you think so?
Yeah, it seems almost every time the same. And hopefully we get to a point where we have also a little bit more financial fairness there in terms of maybe redistributing, especially TV monies in a different way. I think at one point it might get boring for also the spectators, if you always have the same champion. And I think it's something definitely to consider. Of course, we are not alone in the German Football League. It's a European business. But I think, I don't know whether the spectators will lose the interest at one point if you always have the same champion.
Well, Alex, that was it. Thanks a lot for your time and the conversation. I wish you and our listeners all the best for the coming and certainly still challenging time. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Stephanie. Thank you.